I'm not dead.
That sounds like something interesting. Hi, I'm Rick Dancer. Welcome to Rick Dancer TV. We're on 6th Avenue in front of the 6th Street Bar and Grill. Linda Addison, she's the owner of this place, this beautiful restaurant with really good steak.
Yes, it is steak and ale night.
First question, somebody wrote me on Facebook and I forgot to tell you I was going to ask you this one, but why is it the 6th Street Grill when it's on 6th Avenue?
You know, that started from way back. They came up with it was 6th Street and there was a little bit of confusion whether it was a street or an avenue. They named the building that and it stuck, but we actually have the original 6th Avenue sign in our bar that shows that yes, we really are 6th Avenue even though everybody knows it's a 6th Street. So to avoid any confusion, you can always find us right across from the Hope Center.
Yeah, that's right. Now, what do you call this part of town? Is this the north? This is the north downtown?
This is the north side of downtown, and we've kind of dubbed this area as kind of the arts and entertainment district because you've got the Hilton, you've got the Holt Center, you've got the 5th Street Public Market that's just a few blocks down. Brian Obie's going to be doing a new piece.
How excited are you about the possibility of that happening?
We are extremely excited because it's going to give us an opportunity to add more retail. There's talk about him adding a movie theater, and it's just going to just really give an overall enhancement to the existing area that we've got. Plus, we've also got the post office, which as everyone knows is up for grabs right now. So we're really excited to see who's gonna come in and really refurbish that and really keep the history of the building.
This section of town really has a lot of the older buildings and old history on this end of town too.
Yeah, it does. And the cool part is that they've been able to not only keep the historic pieces, but then we've also got new neighbors who have really gutted some of the buildings, like our new neighbor, which is Pacific Northwest Publishing, which is right next door to us.
That's a cool building.
They have done an amazing job inside, and they're actually going to be doing the business after hours with us in June, and they're going to be able to spotlight and really showcase their building and all the things that they've done inside.
Well, thanks for being with us. We're going to hang out here the whole show, so we should just go inside and start.
And have a steak and ale.
I recently got a message on Facebook from a woman who was telling me that the bridge to the Cape Arago Lighthouse was being taken down. I used to work in Coos Bay, North Bend. That was my first job. And I'd done a lot of stories over the years on that bridge and on the lighthouse out there on the island. So I had a connection. So I got my camera, made some phone calls, talked to the tribe, talked to the destruction company, the folks taking down the bridge, got a friend, and went down to the bridge. Here's the story. When I found out that they were going to tear down the bridge between land and the Cape Arago Lighthouse, there was something in me that just, I had to come out here. The bridge needs to be replaced. The cost, about $1 million. So instead, the Coast Guard will dismantle the bridge. We contacted the Confederated Tribes of Coos, Lower Umpqua, and Siuslaw Indians to see if they'd meet us for one last trip to Chief's Island.
Well, it's Chief's Island because it is, you know, one of the places that where the chiefs would come to. And, you know, there are some great stories that go back not only of Chief's Island, but of Women and Children's Island, of what happened here. People that were being forcibly removed and moved up to Yahats to encampment, and of the stories of how the chiefs actually helped hit people on the island, you know, to keep them away from the United States Army.
I don't know what it is. The Native Americans say there's something spiritual about this place, and I agree.
Kathy and I visited the area and stayed in the shadow of this island several times. We'd come here to rest, to make important decisions. We came here right after we found out I had cancer. We came here to escape. Very soon, this island and some surrounding acreage will be transferred back to the tribe by congressional order.
You know, the lighthouse that is on the island is the third lighthouse that's been there since 1866. You know, the very first one lasted just a few years, and this lighthouse, I believe, came in 1930. There are a number of people that are buried out in this area. Certainly, tribal members have been buried here for literally 10,000 years.
Oh man, we are at the top of the lighthouse. This is so awesome.
tribal member's perspective, it would be important to both preserve this place, preserve its history, and to keep it, you know, as a very, very special and spiritual place, not for economic development, but certainly as a spiritual and a cultural icon for our people.
And yeah, maybe I'm over spiritualizing it. I don't know. I don't think so. I think there's something that I needed to be here today. I just needed to be here today. That's all. We want to spend some time talking about autism tonight. April's Autism Awareness Month, and Lane County has a large population of people with autism. There's a place in Lane County called the Bridgeway House. It's a school for children with autism. We're going to introduce you to this place, and then we're going to talk to the director to find out more about what we can do as the population to help.
We are so lucky. This community is so lucky to have this school. You want your kids to be loved, and I love who he is. And I love that other people now love who he is.
They actually understood me, so I thought, like, I finally found where I'm supposed to be.
There's nothing to compare it to. This is a unique and precious thing that Eugene has. And I can say that one of the reasons we still live here is because of Bridgeway House. It's invaluable. You can't put a price on it. Because that's just, it's so rare.
It's a pretty big thing because, yeah, it's pretty big. When I come back from Bridgeway House, I'm ready to take on anything.
I think there is a magic to Bridgeway House. And I've also never worked anywhere where the staff is as devoted and caring, and they seem like they just want to be here and they want to help so much. And I think that has a certain magic to it. And the kids must feel that. They must feel coming in that how wanted they are and how much the people here want to understand them and want to work with them and want the best for them.
It all feels so very right. It's pretty wonderful. It's really a treat, privilege, everything to be associated with it.
Well, now seeing the growth from a small room to a small building to a larger building to overtaking a larger building to looking for more space, I just thought it was just an unbelievable undertaking.
A facility like this, you know, in some respects an ideal facility that then as soon as you move into is bursting at the seams and, you know, wanting to expand into the rest of the building and things like that. Yeah, it's really, really warming and moving. Yes.
Hi, I'm Rick Dancer, and we're here with the WaterCooler with Patricia Wigney, and you are the director here at the Bridgeway House. And we've just seen a video on what that is. Talk to me about autism, because we have, Eugene Springfield has a high population of folks with autism on the autism spectrum, don't we?
We do. We have one of the higher numbers in the nation here in Lane County.
Why is that? Do we know?
There's multiple reasons why. Better diagnosing here, better services, and more acceptance. Even though we need to have more acceptance in our community, more education, Eugene does a really good job of it.
What don't we know about, what doesn't the general population understand about folks with autism?
Well, that they're just like you and me. They just think differently and need things done differently in their lives, structured differently.
Very black and white?
For some, yes. Yes. Lacking social skills is a really big piece of Asperger's and autism.
And there's a spectrum. It used to be called, on one end was Asperger's and at the other end was autism, and now they are different in the way they process and do things, but it's in terms of services for kids especially, it's all been grouped together.
It has been grouped together. Medically now it's a diagnosis called autism spectrum disorder. They put it under one umbrella, so it's referred to as ASD.
Are there just a lot of people, what I find the more I learn about this is a lot of people I know just out in everyday life are on that spectrum. and are vital humans working in the community, doing all these kind of things, but just think differently than what is considered the population base.
That's right. If more than likely, everybody knows somebody on the spectrum. You may think you don't, but you do. It may be your doctor, it may be the lawyer that you work with, or the boy that delivers your newspapers.
You said more acceptance. What would it look like? You're with these children every day. What do they need most from the folks out there in the community, really?
Tolerance. If you're in a supermarket and you see a child melting down in a way that you've never seen, to not make a judgment of the parent, of the child, to think that they maybe they have something else going on, to think differently, to think maybe those lights are bothering them, or the noise, or too many people, or something we don't even hear ourselves. So there's a lot of tolerance, patience, and that go into accepting and understanding that they're wired differently.
The more you understand about this condition, the more you start all of a sudden looking at folks and going, you know, maybe I'm not as weird as I thought I was.
Yes.
You know, I mean, you know what I mean? And you start looking at people and thinking, maybe that's really just something that is just to color the world in a different way than it is that they're weird and different and odd. Mm-hmm. Because I think we're, like you said, we're all kind of different and odd in our own ways.
We are. It's a human spectrum. And working in the field, I work with so many children and adults with autism. When I go out, supposedly with the typical people, I find that they're difficult to deal with, where I'm so clear to communicate with people with autism. They know exactly what they want and exactly how to do it, and it needs to be clear for them.
And the honesty. You know what?
Oh, yes, very honest.
Yeah. You will not walk away knowing that if something you did was inappropriate or wrong, you will know it, won't you?
You know exactly where you stand with the person with autism.
Well, thank you for joining us on the Water Cooler. For me personally, I love what you do. I think it makes a huge difference for a lot of people in our community. And kudos to you. And thanks for being with us
today.
Thank
you very much.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Thank you.
Emma, well, imagine finding you at the 6th Street Bar and Grill at the bar.
What can I say, Rick? It's been that kind of day.
So what are you drinking?
I don't know. Paul, what are we making?
How about a Hawaiian Rainbow?
How about Mahalo? Yes.
I hear there's a pot of gold at the end.
Really?
So did you know they have a special here almost every night of the week?
Yeah, I'm having steak later.
Steak and ale tonight.
Steak day.
And I talked to Linda and she said we can get you back in the kitchen to pick out your steak.
I've been cleared for the kitchen.
Well, we had to do a background check and...
I was worried.
Yeah, well, there was a few things that came back, but we won't talk about those. So did you see the video we did for Linda?
It looked really good. Actually, Linda's a delight. It was really nice to meet her and let's check out the video.
I think that 6th Street Grill has stood the test of time. When Keith and I first got married, one of the things that we really wanted to do was to kind of take control of our own destiny.
How are you doing?
Good. How are you?
We really felt that, you know, great moments are born out of great opportunity. And this was a great opportunity for us that we just couldn't pass up. So we took a leap of faith and jumped in with both feet, and here we are 16 years later. Our food doesn't come out of a bag. It doesn't just come out of a can. Our spices, our dressings, everything is made from scratch, because that's what we want to be able to be known for, is that, you know, you're not going to be able to just go to the grocery store and find the exact same thing and then throw it on a plate. Our stuff is done by hand, strict specifications that are done fresh and made daily. Well, we are actually right across from the Eugene Hilton and the Holt Center. You know, it's funny, people say, oh, you don't have much parking, and I'm like, well, hold on a second, because everyone assumes it's just the parking in back, when in actuality, right across the street from us, and we're talking a stone's throw or less, we've got 5 levels of parking that's free after 5 o'clock. Sunday is our $10 gourmet, and I think the biggest thing that people are shocked by is they kind of presume that it's going to be like a smaller meal, or it's not going to have all the bells and whistles with it. Monday is our 3-2-1 beer run, and that's been extremely popular with, surprisingly, a wide variety. Tuesday is Burger and Brew, and that's kind of really one of our signature nights. We actually started Burger and Brew 16 years ago, so 6th Street Grill is the original home of Burger and Brew. Wednesday is a newer special that we've just started, and we've really had a really good response to it, and that's our Steak and Ale Night, and that's $14.95, and there's 6 different choices of an 8-ounce New York steak. Thursday is our $3 Thirsty Thursday night, and it's also our trivia night, and that's also something that's really started to take off. Yeah, the restaurant is a little bit quieter, a little more tailored towards folks that are wanting to have maybe a little more conversation, maybe more family-oriented, that type of deal. And then on the bar side, there's a reason why we have doors separating the restaurant from the bar, because it does get a little rowdy in there sometimes. People are cheering for their sporting events. People say, God, you know, why would you ever want to own a restaurant? That is one of the hardest things to ever do. It's insane. You're crazy. And then it's like, you know what? I honestly can't imagine doing anything else. I absolutely love what I do. And that's what we hope that we really are able to impart to our guests.
And for you, Emma. Aloha.
Wow. That's the Hawaiian punch.
Thank you,
Paul. I have a feeling that's not like the kind of Hawaiian punch you drank when you were a kid.
I will show you a Hawaiian punch. Oh, remember when I was telling you about how I needed a new computer?
Yeah.
And you know how I love Goodwill Hunting?
Yes.
Put those hands together. I found a Goodwill computer store.
I love going to Goodwill. I'm getting rid of my computer and I need a new one. So guess what? Goodwill has a computer store. Let's check it out.
Ooh, it's hooked up. I'm gonna sign Rick up for match.com. I'm sure Kathy won't mind. She's been trying to get rid of him, pretty sure. All right, they have keyboards, all different keyboards. They have different mice. Ooh, the fancy ones. They have all the cords that you misplace or forget where they are. Maybe you lose them. Ooh, I forgot. I needed one of these, actually. I need this. I'm gonna have to talk to Rick about getting a raise or getting paid in general. Of this stuff. They have accessories. They have everything you need for your computer, and you can bring your old one here. So if you need to find a computer or drop yours off, Goodwill Computer Store on Delta. Come here. Seriously, they have everything. What's up, boys?
Hello!
Hey, it's Steak and Ale Night. Who's on my steak tonight? Yes! Yes, way to be excited.
Emma, excuse me, what are you doing in the kitchen? Are you controlling the chefs making your steak?
Mind your business, dancer.
Wow, unbelievable.
Anyway, seriously.
Well, anyway, while Emma's getting her steak cooked just the way she wants it, we wanted to talk to you about gardening. LCC does a lot of work in fitness, and they're telling us before you go out and garden, you need to be sure you do stretching.
That is hilarious.
Hi, my name is Terry Pemberton, and I work at Lane Community College in the Exercise and Movement Science program. Talk about dynamic stretching today, so talking about stretching with movement. This is going to help prepare your body better for your activity that you're doing. It's also going to help you warm up and then make that muscle-to-brain connection so that you're more efficient when you are doing your activity. For dynamic stretching, you want to think about the movements that you're actually going to perform in your activity and mimic them. So about movements that you can do with legs, so coming in, hugging in your knee into your chest, getting that nice little stretch as you're going through. You ever do karaoke?
You mean for real?
What's no, that? Not karaoke.
Is that an this exercise?
Kind of stuff? Yes, karaoke. Not karaoke singing. Side-to-side stuff, so doing some karaoke. One of my favorite ones is doing a lunge walk. So you actually get some great leg exercises and some upper body. You're gonna come in and you wanna make sure as you step out that when you come down into your lunge, you go straight down and you're gonna bring your arm as much down to the floor that you can touch. Get a nice stretch through your back. Come up, do the next one, and come back down.
So Tara, what are we gonna do next time?
Well, next time we're gonna get a jug of water. We're gonna incorporate some arm and back exercises so that we can get you ready for some weed pulling.
Like I wanna get ready for weed pulling.
So everyone's giving away food. Sixth Street is giving away a dinner for two, and Ranchito Grill decided to get in on the action. So they have a dinner for two as well. All you have to do is drop off your business card, and it'll say Rick Dancer TV, really easy to find. Go to Ranchito Grill, drop it in there, or a piece of paper with your email and phone number on it. And we're gonna do a drawing next month, and you could win free food from Ranchito Grill. Good luck.
So we make our food from scratch, and people that we have as employees, they really care about how the food tastes. So they make sure that it's really good and authentic Mexican food. The only Americanized part, you know, on these recipes are the melted cheese over, because people here like the melted cheese, you know. And in Mexico, we don't use that, but the flavor in the recipes and the ingredients, we use, you know, all Mexican ingredients. But the only thing is Americanized is just to melt the cheese over.
Oh! That was...
You're losing.
No!
I can see there's TVs everywhere in this room. That's what the 6th Street Bar and Grill is all about.
That was in.
Hey, does it feel like we're becoming like the Food Network or something? We're giving away food from Ranchito Grill and 6th Street Bar and Grill.
It all sounds good too. Can I win?
No. So I gotta tell you about a bike ride. Century, a metric century, Pedal for People. It comes on May 11th. So Pedal for People's a bike ride started last year, and it goes to support the Oregon Supported Living Program. I have a brother-in-law who has a disability. He lives in a group home with this organization. This is a fundraiser. So you really are pedaling for people.
I like it.
Do you wanna go?
Yeah, can I ride the bike?
65 miles, can you do that? She's gonna die. There's a media class at Cottage Grove High School, and they actually put on a news program for their school. They let me come down and give them some pointers on how to tell a story and how to shoot. And these kids, it's so great because they really listen and they get it. They're not afraid to go to the edge and do something a little different. So the other day they sent me a copy of a story they did, and I found it on YouTube and I was like, oh my gosh, these kids are awesome. Gabby Howell, a senior at Cottage Grove High School, produced this, and I said, you have to see this.
away from the opportunity of these things. So we've come to cash this check, a check that will give us upon demand the riches of freedom and the security of justice. We have also come to this hallowed spot to remind America of the
kind of makes you want to dream a little more, doesn't it? Those are high school kids from Cottage Grove. Tell me my job's not threatened in the future. Hey, I wanted to end the show with something a little bit of a somber note. A couple of people who are really important to this community passed away last month, and I think you need to pay honor to people like that. But this is kind of maybe not the place. Can you guys step outside with me? I want to talk to you about this. Suzanne Arlie was an entrepreneur, a businesswoman, and a friend to just about every nonprofit in this area. She gave and she gave and she gave. She was also a friend to a lot of people like me. When I had cancer, she was there for me, and she was there for a lot of other people with the same disease. Suzanne passed away, and the neat thing about her was a lot of people in this community for generations are going to be helped by the things she did, and that's not why she did it. She did it because it was the right thing to do. And Suzanne, we're going to miss you. Riley Campbell is another important person who passed away last month. Great guy. You can still see his smile shining in this community. He used to walk around Coburg Road and the Willikinsey area and over by Marketer Choice and Sheldon High School. People around there knew Riley. He didn't communicate like the rest of us do, but he told people, he showed people that people with disabilities matter, and that people with disabilities can be just like everybody else. So Riley and Suzanne, you're gonna be missed. I just thought you should know.